Before I introduce the panel, I'd like to present a little position. In an article published last year, the Chattanooga, Tennessee's Electric Power Board, they reported that its high-speed broadband network, launched in 2010, delivered $2.7 billion in economic and social benefits to their community. That happened in the first decade of its operation. So not bad results, right? But there's much more to that headline. It points, of course, to Chattanooga's application of this super connectivity to help in bridging the digital divide in that community, helping in job creation and supporting its smart grid. But it also helped entrepreneurs and the educational institutions, as well as helping in lowering its carbon footprint. So it did quite a lot. Now, many other cities around the world are also looking at that and looking at its infrastructure, as well as how it is able to use it to attract and retain jobs, investment, and talent. Here today to talk about that, we have some of our economic development representatives from communities around the world. They've benefited from those digital bits in their communities, and I'm going to be asking them how they have been able to turn those bits into coin and how it's been able to benefit their communities for economic and social benefit. So we have with us today Rose Klukas, who's the Economic Development Officer for the city of Campbell in British Columbia in Canada. She's one of our Economic Development Association of Canada representatives. We have Ron Gaudet, who's the president of Gaudet and Associates. He's also 360 Bespoke Consulting in St. John, New Brunswick, Canada, also a representative of EDAC. We have Sindy Yeh, who's a senior business ambassador with Arlington Economic Development in Arlington, Virginia, in the United States. And we have Tiffany Bauer, who's the project officer with Economic Development and Future Industries in the Sunshine Coast in Queensland, Australia. And she's a representative of EDA in Australia. So thanks to EDAC and thanks to EDA for helping us out in this particular program. Now, before we begin, I'd like to invite each of the panelists to take a moment to further introduce themselves and to briefly, in about a minute or so, describe your community and its digital infrastructure and any key results from utilizing it for social, cultural, and economic benefit. Can we start with Rose, please? Hi, Rose.
Thank you. And first of all, I'd like to acknowledge that I'm coming to you today from the territory of the Liquitoq people of the Wiwakam and the Wiwakai Nations. And I am super pleased to be invited to speak today. I come from the city of Campbell River, which is on the east coast of Vancouver Island in British Columbia. Our community is about 40,000 people. And I think we've done some pretty great things for a community of our size using digital connectivity. And, you know, a lot of my work is in traditional economic development initiatives like large industry and tourism, but we are also working very hard to create initiatives using innovation and technology and connectivity. So Campbell River is well served by major telcos, but we also were the first municipality on Vancouver Island to install our own municipal broadband network. And I think I'll chat about that a little bit later on as well. And so just as a side note, my first interaction with ICF and John was when we, the city of Campbell River, applied for the federal government's Smart Cities Challenge. And that's when we really started to look at digital connectivity and smart city initiatives as ways to solve problems in our communities that are not unlike problems in communities all around the world. But again, I'll speak a bit more to that a little bit later.
Thank you. Ron, can we hear from you for just a minute or so?
Certainly, and thank you, John and Robert and fellow panelists. Great to be here with you. As they said, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. We are 10:13 here PM on the east coast of Canada. So my name is Ron Gaudet. I've been in the field of community economic development for over 30 years. I've been honored to lead several regional economic development agencies, both in Eastern and Central Canada, but have really worked across the nation with many, many communities. And currently I work with communities and organizations on their particular growth strategies. Like the previous presenter, I've had the occasion to work with the ICF on the 21 Communities Forum. Two of the communities we've worked with have ended up in the top seven, so that's been very rewarding. And one of the communities, that's when I was a practitioner from a consulting perspective, I've worked with communities that actually been number one for the year. So that's also gratifying. My perspective this evening, morning, whatever your perspective is going to try to explain a little bit of what's happening in a Canadian context. And then if time permits, I will go to a couple of remote local examples of the utilization of broadband. But I hope that just because I'm not tied to a particular community right now, I work for several communities. So anyway, thank you, John. Nice to be here.
Well, thank you. And if we can now go to, let's go to Sindy.
Sure. Yeah, you can all hear me. And Ron, actually, I'm looking forward to hearing you from different jurisdictions, different communities' perspective. I am Sindy with Arlington Economic Development in Arlington, Virginia. Arlington, for those of you who, just to set the tone here, Arlington is right outside of Washington, D.C., in the East Coast of the United States. It's a dense urban community, about 235,000 people within 26 square miles or 67 square kilometers, with metro stations connecting to Washington, D.C. We call it a county, but really it's a city. You know, you may have heard of Arlington County as, you know, Arlington Cemetery, as well as the Pentagon, the U.S. Department of Defense. They are all in Arlington. And more recently, you may have heard of Amazon HQ2. It's the second, for economic development people, we all know about the Amazon. Amazon selected Arlington as its second headquarters. Because of the proximity to DC and the Pentagon, most of the industries in Arlington includes aerospace and defense, and lots of federal government contractors, mostly in the information technology sectors. In terms of digital infrastructure, Arlington has pretty robust digital infrastructure network, in addition to all the privately owned infrastructure such as Fios, cable, and satellite. That connects to all the business and residential areas. I do have to mention that in 2015, the county government itself has constructed a 10-mile ring of dark fiber called Connect Arlington through the major commercial corridors throughout the county. It provides connectivity for county government buildings, public school facilities, as well as for transportation and public safety needs, such as, you know, connecting traffic cameras, traffic lights, and for use for emergency services. I look forward to hearing from everyone.
Well, thank you, Sindy. And now Tiffany, all the way down under.
Good afternoon from the Sunshine Coast in Queensland, Australia. I'm actually coming to you today from the lands of the Cubby Cubby people. Great to be here today. Just very quickly, at Sunshine Coast Council, I'm actually responsible for facilitating the development of our innovation ecosystem and emerging industries, particularly digital technology and screen. The Sunshine Coast, for those who don't know, is a regional centre in Queensland, Australia. Our population is just over 300,000, and we're located just over an hour's drive from Queensland's capital city of Brisbane. The Sunshine Coast is probably most well known as a favourite vacation and lifestyle destination, with our ideal climate, abundance of nature, and also great infrastructure. We are also, however, known as one of Australia's fastest growing regions, but we're also building a reputation as a region that is successfully facilitating sustainable growth. And this was based on a vision that was articulated in consultation with our community back in 2013 through three strategic plans, our economic development strategy, community strategy, and environment and livability strategy. And those have become three guiding documents and visions that we use throughout our planning. So just a little bit about our digital infrastructure, and there's a bit of a story. Back in 2000, Sunshine Coast Council actually set a long-term vision to improve our broadband infrastructure and services to the community. And the reason for this was to improve connectivity, drive affordability, and remove barriers to entry. So, you know, here we are in 2023, and we're really starting to see the results of some of these projects, and most significant of which is the installation and connection of our Sunshine Coast International Broadband undersea cable, which landed in 2020, and we now have a edge data center to complement that. So this really highlighted, I guess, a project that was a whole of region, took a whole of region approach, which was part of our smart city solution, including Wi-Fi and free public Wi-Fi networks as well. So I guess what this is saying is that, you know, the results of this have been cheaper internet. We have more choice for our community, and it's also becoming a key driver of our investment attraction strategy to attract new businesses and diverse our economy.
Well, thank you, Tiffany. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to hopefully begin a discussion with everyone. This isn't just a Q&A. We're going to talk a little bit about connectivity and whether you think that good connectivity in your communities is a real competitive edge that you can sell in a community. Now, Ron, you're saying that you're not going to be talking about a specific community, but I do know that you know places like Kitchener, Waterloo, Moncton, and specifically where you are right now, St. John, quite well. You can talk about any place in Canada, but you know, think about those communities when you're talking about this. So you heard about Chattanooga and the $2.7 billion that they were able to create for economic development benefit for their community. From my perspective as an economic developer, I would think that any kind of connectivity like that should be able to sell their community. And I know, Tiffany, that the kind of connectivity that's come in with the hub that you've just developed with the cable coming into your community, those are real selling points. Do you agree or disagree as economic developers? Is this one of the key competitive edges for communities? Anyone?
Well, yes, I completely agree with that. And our international broadband network and the infrastructure that has come around that has definitely become a key selling point for our investment attraction team. And we are seeing inquiry coming out of that. And also, you know, it's the diversification of industries, you know, that I think is a real bonus for us. And in terms for the Sunshine Coast, I guess it's just complementing a great lifestyle that we offer here with connectivity, meaning that businesses can set up here, they want to relocate here, but also that our existing local businesses can scale. Now they now have the scope to scale. Previously, they may have had to look at moving to a capital city, but now they're able to actually develop their businesses here. And also, I guess the other thing as well is it's giving us the ability to develop new industries here as well.
What is the number one attraction though for people and companies coming to the Sunshine Coast? It's not connectivity, is it?
No, I'd say at this stage and in a post-COVID world, it is, for a lot of them, it is lifestyle and also access. So the Sunshine Coast has the advantage of being a great lifestyle destination, but we still have pretty good access to a capital city. We also have an international airport as well, which was another thing that was developed in tandem with our broadband infrastructure as well. So it means that people can get here easily, go to other capital cities very easily. So I actually think it's a combination of those things that people are looking for.
But just to stay on that for a second, if you didn't have as good a connectivity as you have, do you think it would be a huge disadvantage to attract some of those companies and the talent? I mean, you've got universities and everything in the area coming to the area and requiring that broadband capability. So where does it sit? I mean, you've got tourism, you've got lifestyle, connectivity, talent. Where does connectivity sit in there? One, two, three, four?
I'd say it's something that's changing over time. So I would actually put that as probably number two or three. The lifestyle is almost the shop window. You know, it's what goes in the shop window, and that is what people are initially attracted to. And that's what the Sunshine Coast at this point in time is known for. And it's partly our job to make sure that the Sunshine Coast is known for more than that, and more than simply a tourist or holiday destination, and making it known that there are other vibrant, thriving industries here, particularly around technology, advanced manufacturing, and professional services, and they can all be conducted effectively here from the Sunshine Coast.
I do note that you don't have a fiber cable behind you. You definitely have palm trees in the beaches.
Yes.
Okay, well, thank you. Cindy, what do you think? I mean, where does connectivity and importance for having that competitive edge? I mean, I'm talking about competition here with other communities, other regions, other countries. Where do you think it sits in terms of the greater Washington and particularly the Arlington area?
Well, absolutely. It definitely is important to be a differentiator in attracting companies and retaining jobs and all of these economic development goals. However, I believe that everyone on the panel has to agree that the most important factor in attracting businesses is not just connectivity. It's all these other assets, the local assets that you already have, such as, you know, education, workforce, transit, livability. All of that, I think, ranks higher than connectivity. I hate to say that. You know, you have to have connectivity, at least where I'm sitting. All the Washington, D.C. have pretty superior connectivity. It's almost a baseline now. You have to have this basic connectivity. I know we can go into it later on about some of these other things to attract cutting edge technologies. Having the connectivity is just the baseline.
Okay, but it is important. Mm-hmm.
Yes, of course. Yes.
And that's how ICF really got started. I mean, we talked about broadband and the whole sort of smart city environment. Mm-hmm. In fact, the first conference we had around this topic was back in 1995, called Smart 95, and we talked about mm-hmm. how smart buildings, smart people, smart cities, yeah. Mm-hmm. but you needed that connectivity, right? But mm-hmm. but we all agreed that that's not where it should stop, that it should be focused mm-hmm. on a people first perspective. So I'd like to hear from Rose, how important is connectivity up in Campbell River?
Yeah, so interesting conversation, because my perspective now is going to come from a smaller community in a less mm-hmm. on a less populated island. So I agree, Cindy, that there's other things that draw people to community, and connectivity is maybe not the top of the list. I would put it near the top of the list. And I can speak from being in communities that don't have as great access mm-hmm. to the internet as many communities do, and the disadvantage to that. So our own city here, City of Campbell River, identified not the access in our community, but the affordability and the access mm-hmm. to enterprise, so equal upload and download speed internet, as a barrier to drawing in businesses to our community, and which is why we made our investment in a municipal broadband network called CR Advantage. But interestingly, as we speak, our provincial government has also made an investment in the Connected Coast project to bring fiber along from the central coast of British Columbia around Vancouver Island, bringing connectivity to many, including many First Nations communities that have no access to internet. So it's critical. We're not going to see a lot of business development opportunities in our communities without that connectivity. And Canada, of course, is a large country. A lot of area to cover. We're also seeing within our communities that traditional sectors of our economy, like forestry or aquaculture, can only stay and grow if they have access to connectivity. It's been very important for us. And I can say the other interesting things that has been an outcome of the investment in our municipal broadband, which is not a huge line, it's in our downtown core, but it drew out some people into our community who formed an angel investor group. And for a community of 40,000 people, that's a fairly significant contribution. And their real contribution is to me in economic development. They wanted to help grow technology and innovation within our community. So we've been able to launch our next stream tech challenges. We've had 3 years of those. And last year they invested over $2 million. And again, for a community of our size, those are huge investments. And they said it was based on the fact that they saw our community invest in broadband.
So Ron, you heard now a number of different perspectives. What about you in New Brunswick? What's the importance of broadband for the communities there and across Canada?
Okay, well, thank you, John. And you got me thinking, so now I'm just gonna throw my notes out. And we'll start, as you say, you pull me back to reality here, but you know, you made a really interesting comment when you pointed to Moncton and Waterloo, and I've had a lot of experience there and Halifax. If we think of those really innovative communities in Canada as early adapters to the whole connectivity challenge, if you will. And then just yesterday, I was listening to a report. And so in a Canadian context where we have, you know, thousands of communities, the top three growing communities in Canada, Moncton number one at 5.5% in the last year, Halifax at just over 3%, and Waterloo at 2.5%. So one would make the leap of logic here that these three early adopters of connectivity some years ago are now leading the country in growth post-COVID, right? So why have we had that in-migration and immigration into those regions? I can speak profoundly from Moncton, where I'm at today. Why is it leading the country in growth? Certainly quality of life, the other factors that have been mentioned here, right? A strong industrial base, an innovative base, a strong startup ecosystem. And most, I think it would be hard to argue that connectivity has not played a significant role. Because in a Canadian context, when you talk about Moncton versus a Toronto, Montreal, Vancouver, which are major urban centers, Ottawa, Moncton is a pretty small urban center. We're about 175,000 people today. The draw has been that people could come for the quality of life, but not forsake the connectivity, and that they could continue to operate their businesses. And we've seen that, and I'm sure many other countries have, but we've seen that across this nation. So from a Canadian context, the challenge with that becomes those early adopters, and this point was made, has become the point of entry today. So in a Canadian context, we're now at what would be called a mid-level 5G status. In other words, that's very good. As a nation with over 6,000 kilometers from the East Coast to the West Coast, to have that kind of connectivity on a national basis is phenomenal. But the type of connectivity we will need over the next decade to get us to what's called a true 5G is going to ramp up that by the power of 10, more like 15%. And on the reality there is that will belong to the major urban centers because of the layout of the technology and this need for conductors or little transmitters every 20 feet. So in a country the size of Canada, while we will have very, very good connectivity across our nation, those larger urban centers will have the capacity for autonomous vehicles, really interactive drone activity for healthcare, search and rescue, that type of thing. So it will be interesting, John, Robert, and panel, as to how those early adopters continue to be at the forefront as we roll out both wireless and line.
So going back to Rose's point, she sees broadband, robust broadband connectivity as being a much more important factor in economic development, competitiveness for a place like Campbell River, certainly for a lot of smaller communities. Clearly larger communities already have a fairly significant broadband capability and companies are already in those communities, but to attract it to a smaller communities, to have a company come in, unless you have those essential ingredients, high-speed broadband, the talent that they're looking for, and maybe some other natural resource or competitive advantage, they're just not going to go. And to your point, 5G is going to limit it even further. Rose and Cindy and Tiffany, do you have other points of view from this perspective?
Well, I just want to say that is exactly the reason we've made the investments we've had. I think Tiffany, you made a comment as well that part of the reason we invested in our own municipal broadband network was to put a bit of competition into the major telcos to bring down the price of internet, which is also fairly expensive here in Canada. And we have seen that be successful, but it's absolutely true. We have a community on Vancouver Island. It's a beautiful lifestyle. We can claim that for sure. And we are seeing more people interested in coming here. I think COVID has definitely brought attention to our area. People are interested in space, which we still have because we are not densely populated. But if they can't work from our communities, if they can't connect, they're not going to come here. And that's the remote worker part. But we're also interested in anchor tenants to grow our economies here.
Tiffany, did you have any?
I don't really have anything else to add because I guess the experience here echoes what everyone else has said that, our initial attraction for people is lifestyle and livability because that's what we're known for. And having this connectivity means that people are able to move here, establish business, grow, attract talent, retain talent as well is another important thing. We have a lot of young people here who previously would have left, to find work and study. And we're you know, part of our objective is to retain those people here. So it all works in tandem. And for the Sunshine Coast, it is also about having those other infrastructure projects happening at the same time. So they all complement each other. And also just being aware that we're growing in a sustainable manner as well. And I think the technology helps with that. It means that we can attract industries that are cleaner. I'm doing that in inverted commas, but you know, it means that we can help to attract those type of industries that support that community vision.
Well, for the few minutes that we have left, maybe it's important for us to pivot a little bit and go away from just saying technology by itself is going to create that, you know, competitive edge. I think Sindy said it, that, you know, yes, you have all this ability to communicate, but there's so much more, as you've said too, Tiffany, so much more in a community that site locators are looking for. They're looking for how you solve all sorts of solutions in a community. To, you know, you're going to be pointing out how there's less crime in your community as a result of certain things, and that you have access to food and food security, that you have all of the lifestyle ingredients that you've mentioned, Tiffany, and many, many other areas. What about housing affordability and having a net zero target and so forth? How are those competitive components factor into selling your communities? Do you want to start, Sindy, at your end?
I'm just trying to think about it. Of course, connectivity. I'm trying to look at my notes and think about what to say. I know during COVID, for the last few years, health equity is a major concern for Arlington. So Arlington end up, as I mentioned earlier, we have this Connect Arlington dark fiber in the ground. It's in the ground. So what we did is actually gave it for free to one of the clinics, free clinic that mostly service low-income residents, to allow the clinic to have connectivity to the major hospital in the area, to have access to telemedicine, telehealth, and have access to medical records. So we use this connectivity for health equity purposes. So that's just one example that we use.
And you wouldn't be able to do that if you didn't have really good connectivity.
That's right. That's right. So that's one thing.
Connectivity just gives you the ante in to be able to do this so well. Yeah,
correct.
Of course. Mm-hmm. Now, Rose, from your end, what kind of applications and uses do you see the connectivity actually benefiting your community and helping to attract more people and companies to your community as a result?
Well, a couple of things that are maybe plaguing many communities and growth. For example, workforce. So we know that attracting workforce is difficult across the nation, across the globe. Populations are declining and people are retiring at a faster rate than replacement. We see a few interesting initiatives happening. For example, our provincial government has just announced that starting in April, any job that is possible to be remote can be worked in any community in British Columbia. So presumably that will also address housing. So you can choose communities where you can find and afford housing and apply for jobs with the provincial government. Food security was an issue that we really saw challenged during COVID as well. We are on an island and the supply chain issues, again, plaguing a lot of places, were a challenge for us. What we're seeing is an increased interest in agritech, including vertical gardening and those kind of things, and even here in our town of Campbell River. And the other thing I was thinking about is the same thing, the virtual healthcare. So access to medical professionals through virtual healthcare is taking off. And again, those things could not happen without connectivity.
So Tiffany, what's going on in your world that's unique? We've heard tourism, we've heard a couple of other things. You have a really good university in that area, the Sunshine Coast. Obviously, broadband attracts the students to that area, doesn't it? for that purpose.
Yeah, absolutely. And look, all of the universities did suffer during COVID, particularly, you know, for their attraction of international students, which is something that is starting to come back now. I think on the Sunshine Coast, for us generally, it is about balancing out these competing challenges that we have. The Sunshine Coast, you know, before COVID, was always known as a great place to live, but now it is seen more as a place that people can live and work and grow business. So we're having to now balance out an influx of people from around Australia and around the world, and you know that's obviously had an impact on rentals and our property market as well. We've seen house prices increase quite significantly, and so for our universities as well, attracting students here, they then have to find somewhere to live as well while they're here. So I guess one of the things I think the Sunshine Coast does really well, and connectivity is part of that, is it's our community building. It's the way we work in our industry and business clusters to instigate that innovation and working together, you know, to forward certain industries, certain regions within the Sunshine Coast and certain sectors. And that's been I would say that that's almost like our secret ingredient here. And having that connectivity is just helping facilitate all of those people-based, you know, connections that are also really important in this conversation.
Well, thank you. And Ron, looking more across Canada, how do you see some of the applications of connectivity helping in terms of more of a people-first perspective, creating better opportunities, making it more inclusive, engaging, and so forth. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Thank you, John. Sure. Firstly, I think we need to be very proud as a nation where we're at, where we're sort of at this, you know, we talk about 5G, but there's sort of three phases of 5G, and we're in that mid level right now. And so whether you live in rural Canada or urban Canada, you can be connected and you can run a business very successfully. When it gets to that next exciting level that mm-hmm. we're all dream of, there's this thing called latency that we need to get to a minimal, right? We cannot have a drone delivering a heart to a patient in a hospital and the data connection be lost. We need to be able to transfer seamless, huge amounts of data all across our country. Mm-hmm. And being the second largest geographic country in the world, that comes with complications. That being said, for those centers that invest in it and early adapt, rather they go with the three main telcos mm-hmm. or they use private competitive companies to ensure the infrastructure is in place, then we will see a revolution in the way we do municipal servicing. You know, planners will think they finally arrived in heaven. Economic developers will have tools that they've never had at their disposal, and I think we can see a world where if we can reduce these latency issues, where we can have, when we talk about quality of life, enhanced quality of life, and all kinds of business opportunities from a startup perspective as to how you create this world of tomorrow. And I say that not wanting people to think that we're in some kind of la-la land here. The technology today, the applications across our globe far exceed what our capabilities are in terms of infrastructure. So all that we need to do is focus over the next decade in ensuring that we reduce that gap and we can get to that better tomorrow. So it's a great time to be an economic developer.
Well, thank you, Ron. And you've kind of helped to pivot to the final question that I have. only have a few minutes left for everybody. And you talked a little bit about how we're going to be looking at the future in terms of connectivity. So thank you. I'd like to go to Sindy then. How do you see it moving forward in the future?
Yes, following what Ron said, I live in an urban city. So 5G is all the rage right now in this area where Amazon is moving into. The developer is actually trying to build this 5G smart city. They want to build on the momentum of having Amazon in its backyard. So it purchased like 7 blocks of the CBRS spectrum, covering all of that, the area when called National Landing, where Amazon is going to be. They want to create this futuristic smart city where they can attract of cutting edge technology companies to come in to use the digital infrastructure that the National Landing area will have to conduct cutting edge technology, to use it as a test bed, you know, to develop all these next gen technology. So, you know, that's the future. And we're waiting to see how it's going to go.
Well, it sounds exciting. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking forward to seeing how that all comes together. Thank you, Sindy. Mm-hmm. And Rose, what's happening in the future in Campbell River with mm-hmm. connectivity and people first?
Yeah, well, I think that one of the things that we're really embracing, one of the hats I wear is the president. I'm the president of our Vancouver Island Coast Economic Development Association. Mm-hmm. We have joined forces and pay-to-play models in two kind of initiatives. One is to promote the region as an area for, you know, investment in technology and innovation. But the other one is realizing that we have an opportunity to embrace renewable energy projects here on Vancouver Island. And we do have some, for example, tidal power that hasn't been tapped into, but we can see that future happening. Even more so is, again, the project, the BC's Connected Coast Project, and connecting all of our First Nations communities, many that have no connectivity at all today, mm-hmm. connecting them so that they can embrace opportunities, economic development opportunities within their communities as well. So I think that's an exciting opportunity.
Well, thank you. And can we go to Tiffany? Can you tell us a little bit before we end on what your future plans are in the Sunshine Coast?
A well-timed question, because we're actually just going through a review with our business community of our economic development strategy at the moment. So we are actually going to be one of the host locations for the 2032 Brisbane Olympic and Paralympic Games. So that is really helping to drive our vision for the next 10 years. That coupled with the fact that we've been designated as a UNESCO biosphere. So I think what I see going forward is a region that is balancing out its environmental, social, cultural, and economic needs, making sure that we are diversifying our economy, so and making sure that we're retaining our top talent as well, and creating a place where people can live and work successfully.
Sounds wonderful, and I'd like to thank all of you for your participation today. Are there any last words before we close and go for a short break? Sindy, do you have anything further about your community and how you're looking to attract people to come to your community?
You know, I think COVID affected everybody, and we are all like pivoting and trying to think of new ways to attract companies. So I would just say connectivity is very, very important. And hopefully, like for larger cities, as well as for smaller communities, we can all use connectivity to our advantage and try to work on our strength to attract businesses and help our communities.
Thank you, Sindy. And Ron, do you have any last words of advice?
I don't know if it's advice. I've been around the field for a long time. And, you know, the world as we knew it 20 years ago in economic development, it seems like it's completely flipped on its head. So, you know, 20 years ago in Moncton, as it revitalized, we were promoting, you know, available land, available buildings, available workforce, affordable housing, access to doctors. None of those we can talk about anymore as being available. I do think connectivity will continue to be a major priority. And we just need to make the adjustment to make it more people-oriented. How do we help people to have a better quality of life as we deal with some of these other pertinent issues?
Good point. Thank you. Rose?
Yeah, thank you. And I agree with that. I think more than ever, economic development means community development, quality of life, and focusing on people. We see that because we're concentrating on housing and workforce and health as part of that economic development package. I too have been part of economic development for many years. And I remember the days where really our job was, you know, doing the cold calls to try to attract investment in, usually an industrial investment into your communities. But quality of life is important. Connectivity will allow that. And I've said this several times, but we have many communities who are not, that have not yet seen connectivity. And so that's an important priority, I think. But I really appreciate this conversation. And it's really interesting to hear communities across the globe and of different sizes, but really it all boils down to the same thing. We're serving people.
That's a great point. And finally, last word, Tiffany, down under.
Oh, thanks for the last word. I think as economic developers, I agree with everybody that now the focus is on that triple bottom line now. So we're not just thinking about economy, it's that whole, you know, social, economic, and cultural. And I think a connectivity, more than anything, offers us an opportunity to think differently and look at different ways of doing things and different models. And that is the message I get so clearly when I talk to young people. And I think that to me is a voice that we really need to be listening to a little bit more to make sure that we are really leveraging this connectivity opportunity that we currently have.
And heck, we wouldn't have been able to have this good conversation if we didn't have good connectivity tonight. So thanks to the connectivity gods for helping us keep this going. There have been many days where it didn't work out. So it worked out well today. Thank you very much to everybody here. We're going to end, and I'm going to pass it back to our organizer, Matt Owen, to allow us to go for a break. So thanks, everybody. Thank you. You did a great job. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye now.
Thanks, John.